Making some do-it-yourself biochar can be as cheap and easy as managing a campfire. When done right, there is hardly any ash left over, but a lot of very long-lasting, stable carbon for the garden soil. I start by excavating a cone-shaped pit. The dirt dug from the pit was used to build up around the edge, which reduced the amount of digging needed to reach my target depth. The diameter of the opening ended up measuring about 33 inches, while the depth at the center is only about 14 inches. I planned on making the pit 30 inches wide by 15 inches deep, but it's close enough to work well. Doesn't need to be exact. Should be about twice as wide as it is deep. These dimensions can of course be scaled up or down according to individual needs. Time to build the fire. Some sticks and dried leaves are added to the pit, as well as some straw. I just use what I have on hand. A pile of old tree limbs is mostly what I'm using for feedstock, but some other carbon sources like lumber scraps that are free of any synthetic glues, coatings, or treatments can go in also. I believe just about any non-toxic organic matter containing relatively high amounts of carbon could potentially be pyrolyzed into charcoal. I'll be continuously adding to the fire until I'm about ready to extinguish the flames. The fire needs to stay large enough to consume the oxygen entering the pit in order to prevent the red-hot carbonized wood from reacting with that oxygen and turning to ash, like we see with this fire. I'm careful not to add too much wood at one time, so as to help maintain a more complete and clean combustion. For the most part, there shouldn't be much, if any, smoke except when starting the fire and occasionally when adding material. If the fire isn't going strong enough, then ashes may begin forming in some spots. A handful of dry organic material like leaves, straw, or some small sticks tossed in those areas usually helps to both stop the ashes from forming as well as helping the fire to get going strong again. Some materials are going to burn faster than others. For instance, the lighter weight softwoods tend to burn much faster than the denser hardwoods. But that doesn't matter much to me as long as the fire is going good and no ashes are forming. Lightweight feedstocks like this rotten wood will burn up fast, but the carbon it's made of won't turn to ash as long as the fire protects it from the oxygen. I just keep adding sticks and branches to the pit and stir it once in a while. The largest and densest wood pieces were added as early as possible to give them enough time to burn through. When the pit is almost full, I stop adding to the fire and let it burn itself down. Some small sticks and some old straw are added to keep the fire going if I believe the larger pieces of wood need longer to carbonize. When I think it's about done, I stop feeding the fire. After it dies down some, I extinguish it using plenty of water. The pit can also be covered with a metal sheet or even soil to stop the fire, instead of using water. Just need to make sure the cover is airtight. There are some unburned pieces around the edge, but I'll finish carbonizing them another day. After sorting out most of the unburned pieces, the charcoal is ready. I'm going to store this particular batch uncrushed, but usually I crush it in the pit with a shovel and then mix it into a compost pile right away. Now let's talk about using biochar. It can be applied directly to the garden once inoculation is finished. It can also be added to a compost pile or a compost tumbler like this one, and the compost will charge the biochar as it decomposes. Liquid fertilizers work great as a relatively fast way to load up the charcoal with nutrients. After soaking it for 24 hours, or until fully saturated, it's then incorporated into my soil. I only use organic fertilizers because I want to promote microbial growth, and strong chemical fertilizers are often deadly for microbes. The fertilizer can be specifically tailored for the kind of plants that the biochar will be used with. I just mix the fertilizer with water as per the manufacturer's instructions. And of course, compost teas can work really well for inoculation, particularly aerated compost tea. I generally use a mix of about 5 to 10% biochar to soil. I'm not very precise with it. Much more can be used if desired. 20% is about the most I've used. Too much is wasteful, of course, but it can also be detrimental to your plants if overapplied. The water retention of some soil types can even be reduced when too much charcoal is added, and the lower soil strength can increase its rate of erosion. Some top dressing can be done without charging the biochar first, but a fine particle size would typically be recommended for that. Fine particles are able to slowly make their way down into the ground. The rain and soil, among other things, should inoculate the charcoal before it gets down into the root zone. Granular forms of this micronized biochar are sold to make applying it much easier and less dusty. This micronized product includes humic acid and is very convenient to broadcast onto gardens that have already been planted. And it works for lawns, trees, and shrubs also. I just follow the manufacturer's instructions and do my best to keep it off the plant leaves. Another way of adding fully loaded charcoal to the garden is by spreading a layer of it about a quarter to a half inch thick over the soil and then mulch over the top of it. The mulch will help keep it moist and feed the microbes as it decomposes. Mulch also helps to prevent the charcoal from washing away. If you're interested in biochar, or would like to learn more about how it can benefit your garden, check out the resources in the video description below. Thanks for watching.